And then his secondary education at St. John's College, Dawati in Overland. In 1984, he entered the Pacific Regional Seminary as a candidate for the Archdiocese of Suva. He finished his studies for the priesthood in 1990, graduating with a Bachelor of Divinity with honors. Within a few months, he was ordained deacon and priest on the 11th of January 1992. After his ordination, he served in parishes of Lautoka, Vatukoula, and Solebu before taking up further studies in theology at the Jesuit School of Theology in California. He graduated, he passed his doctorate exams, and defended his thesis in September 2012, and being awarded the degree magna cum laude. He returned to Fiji in December 2012, expecting to take up an appointment as lecturer in Pacific Regional Seminary, but his appointment as Archbishop-elect of Suva took place almost immediately. Graciously and generously, he accepted to teach one course at Pacific Regional Seminary during his first term of 2013. Please, let's welcome our first speaker, His Grace Archbishop Peter Lowe.
Thank you very much, Father Temati, for the welcome and hospitality. I want to begin this presentation. For those who have seen that movie, see, it begins with Maui. He's lost his heart, the fishing hook. And it needs somebody to find that heart. So, and that was Moana will then go and look for the heart. It's a very powerful movie that communicates actually what Pope Francis is communicating in his Laudato Si, how we have lost the heart, our heart, and our mission, like Moana, is to find the heart of Tifiti and bring back the heart and restore what was lost. Like there's no more fish, the coconuts are dead, and everything on the island. See, one time there was abundance of everything. There was coconuts, food, and then something happened. And now their fish traps are not getting the fish. They are harvesting the coconuts, but the inside is no good. Just yesterday, we were having a meeting with some of the church leaders, with the COP23 secretariat, preparing for the meeting in Germany. And the president of the Methodist Church was saying that he just came back from his island. And the people in the village presented him the first fruit of the yams. But you notice something, the yams were big, but inside the yam, there's something not ordinary, something is there, not unusual, something. And he found out later that it was the result of the fertilizers, the chemicals that they put in. The yams are big, but there's some different thing that is happening inside the yams. So that movie, in a way, speaks a lot about the Laudato Si and the ecological conversion that the Pope talks about. My presentation today is not a representation of the Laudato Si. I'm sure you all have read the document. It's about 1 year old now, and So rather than repeating it, I will try to put it into our context in Oceania and especially in Fiji with the help of research that has been done by Caritas, the mapping of the climate profile in Fiji, and then how do we respond to that? How do we regain the heart of the Oceania region, just like what Mona is trying to do? Mona will do that and go out and find the heart of the people in Motuni. And so I'd like to do this by presenting some slides to help my presentation. Yeah, that's what I've just said. That's the position of this presentation, to kind of interpret this and discuss ways of implementing the Pope's encyclical, discuss it in the Oceania context, and so, and with the intent to inspire pastoral action. Eh? Just a little bit overview. These are the areas that I would like to speak on because they highlight the key points of the encyclical. The audience is very important. The source is also very important. The problem statement, the method that Pope Francis uses in his in Laudato Si, and a little bit about the Oceania context in terms of climate change. This is drawn from research done by Caritas. A little bit on the theology, and then I was discuss with Father Temati how we can have some discussion group about responses towards and pastoral action that flows from the encyclical. So Laudato Si marks quite a significant shift in theology, beginning with Pope Leo XIII's Rerum Novarum, and over the years, the focus has been like social justice, common good. Some people make the critic that the theology has been focused on the human person, like the social justice, what is good for the human person. And so in Pope Leo spoke about the rights of workers in response to the outbreak of the Industrial Revolution. Now Pope Francis makes a very important shift. So it's not only about the good of the human person or the common good, but also the good of the environment. So he talks about our common home and the call to conversion in order to also do justice to the environment and to our planet. So from social justice, the shift now is to ecological justice. So just as we have to be just to one another, now we also have to be just to the world, to the planet, to every creature. Because every creature have their own purpose too. We need to respect that. So in Laudato Si 49, it says, we have to realize that a true ecological approach always becomes a social approach. It must integrate questions of justice, in debates on environment so as to hear both the cry of the earth and the cry of the poor. Many books, you know, for some time the Catholic social teaching was the key, one of the key themes there was the cry of the poor, option for the poor. But now, with Pope Francis, and not only Pope Francis, but other thinkers have engaged into, have moved into a very important part, and that is also to hear the cry of the earth. So that marks quite an important shift in theology. Okay, then encyclical takes its name from the invocation of Saint Francis, as Archbishop Martin explained very well during his homily, and it takes its inspiration there. And the Pope reminds us that the earth, our common home, is like a sister whom we share our life, and a beautiful mother who opens her arms to embrace us. We have forgotten that we ourselves are dust of the earth, and our very bodies are made up of her elements of the earth. And we breathe her air, we receive life and refreshment from her waters. So the human community and the earth community together make a single sacred community. There's some pictures of how we are very connected to the earth here. So who is the audience of Laudato Si? In Laudato Si number 3 and 7, it says the encyclical is addressed not only to the members of the church, the Catholic Church, but is a vehicle to enter into dialogue with all people who are united by the same concern. Because we live in the same house and the same problem affects us. And so it's the concern of everybody. Yesterday we met with the COP23, and they were the Fiji Council of Church Leaders, not all of them, all of us, sorry. But one of the difficulties that we have in trying to organize together a prayer week or a service to mark the climate change week that they were proposing is that we have different positions in our doctrine about worship. There are some Christians that cannot worship with Hindus, Muslims, and so it's like our faith divides us. But we live in the same home. The same problem affects us, eh? So somehow we cannot, you know, if you're in the same house, you cannot, if the cyclone comes, you cannot say to a Muslim, stay there, or I don't care for you. The natural thing is we want to save them. But when it, so this is a difficulty when, you know, between how do we care for one another, we're in a common room, but also of different faith. So the Pope is speaking here to everybody, Catholics, Christians, non-Christians, because we live in the same home, and the climate change affects us all the same. So because of the Pope speaks to everybody, his sources too must be broad, must go beyond the Catholic Church traditions. And this is what the Pope does, because of he's speaking to Muslims, he's speaking to Hindus, he's speaking to Catholics, he's speaking to Orthodox Catholics. So he draws from a very wide range in order to communicate in a language that reaches out to Catholics, Christians, and non-Christians. So his main inspirations, as we know, are St. Francis of Assisi and St. Bonaventure. Also Thomas Aquinas is one of the you know, the brilliant doctors of the Church. He draws from the ecumenical patriarch Bartholomew the Archbishop of Constantinople, head of the Eastern Orthodox Church. He draws from the Muslim tradition, the Sufi mystic, those who those who have done the Enneagram know that Enneagram has its roots on the Sufi mystic in order to speak to the Muslim world. He draws from contemporary thinkers like Tayyad Deshadin and Romano Godin, and also he goes beyond the Catholic sources to some secular sources like the Rio Declaration on Environment and Development by the United Nations Conference in 1992, and also from the United Nations 2000 Earth Charter. And this charter is the Earth Charter Initiative is a global movement of organizations and individuals that embrace the Earth Charter and use it to guide the transition towards a more just, sustainable, peaceful world. He draws also from a little bit, Leonardo Boff. There are two brothers, Boff. What's the other one? Leonardo and somebody else. Leonardo Boff, his license to teach theology was taken away. That means he was suspended, disciplined. So he could not any longer teach in a Catholic university. But he wrote a book, The Cry of the Earth and The Cry of the Poor. And I read in the Tablet magazine that Pope Francis called Leonardo for his book, if he could send it to the Vatican. And the article said that normally there's a mainstream way of mail going to the Pope. You know, it goes through a screening process. But this book went through the back door somewhere. if you'll notice even the title of the book, Cry of the Earth, Cry of the Poor, and that is a phrase that the Pope uses a lot. Also, the Pope draws from especially Pope John Paul II and Benedict XV. Also unique in this in Laudato Si is the source that goes beyond the normal traditional way of writing encyclicals, which normally they draw from what previous popes have said. But this encyclical draws from that, but also from the local churches. So you'll see references made to the conference, local conferences of bishops like South Africa, New Zealand, Philippines, Bolivia, which normally did not happen before. So there's a shift from the source, from papal encyclicals to the local churches, meaning that the Pope draws also from the wisdom of the local churches or local bishops' conferences. So you see the sources are important because the Pope wants to speak in a way that reaches out to Catholics, Christians, and beyond. So what is the key problem that the Pope wants to address in Laudato Si? And you'll find this in number two. And it says, now this earth, mistreated, abused, is lamenting. It groans, join those of all the forsaken of the world. This sister now cries out to us because of the harm we have inflicted on her by our irresponsible use and abuse of the goods with which God has endowed her. We have come to see ourselves as her lords and masters, entitled to plunder her at will. So this is the key problem that the Pope wants to address in Laudato Si. Something is wrong in our world, and it is we are held responsible of this. So what can we do to find the heart of Motunui or Te Whiti again. So he says that the earth, our home, is beginning to look more and more like an immense pile of filth, you know. The sister now cries to us because of the harm we have inflicted on her by our irresponsible use and abuse of the goods. So key questions that the encyclical raises in number 160 is, what kind of world do we want to leave to those who come after us, to our children and those who are growing up and those yet to be born? So he says this question doesn't have to do this question does not have to do with the environment alone and in isolation. The issue cannot be approached as a piecemeal, like a small isolated thing, you know. And yesterday when we met with COP23, you know, they were focused on this 1 week of prayer. So I told them, see, it's good to do a prayer, but let's not forget, it's not only about that 1 week of prayer, this is about attitudinal change, you know. You cannot just see the climate change as Germany presidency and then that's all, eh? This is about preparing. It's about changing attitude. It's about changing lifestyle. You cannot take this climate change as a piecemeal, one small dot that stands on its own. So the Pope then says, this leads us to ask ourselves about the meaning of existence. How, why do we live? Its values at the basis of social life. What is the purpose of our life in this world? These are very hard questions the Pope asks us. What is the goal of our work and all our efforts? What need does the earth have of us? So he says, Pope Francis says, unless we struggle with these deeper questions, you know, and for us in Fiji now it's all about this meeting in Bonn, yeah, and a lot of money is coming to this, and but unless we go deep into these questions, and the Pope says, I do not believe that our concern for ecology will produce significant results, you know. Because if we don't go into what's this world for? What's life for? If we don't touch these questions, then all this climate change thing can be a lot about funding, money, and does not touch the heart of the matter. So, a little bit about the method. That is something that has been consistent in the Catholic social teachings. Catholic social teachings are a collection of papal encyclicals, synods of bishops that deal with life, beginning with in 1891 with Pope Leo XIII with the Rerum Novarum. So, and one method that has been consistent in all our social teachings is on this method that is called the See, Judge, Act, which was started by Joseph Cardine in the Industrial Revolution to help young people deal with work problems. And so, in Pope Paul VI especially picked up this in his encyclical. So to see the world, to be able to evaluate the world, to judge, and then to act. And in Laudato Si, you see this coming through. You'll see in the chapter 1, it deals with the problems facing the world. Then chapter 2, it deals with the theology of creation. And then towards the end of the book, it deals with some of the pastoral directives and action that we can do as a response to the problem. So that, and then in, so see, judge, act, Now we have the pastoral circle, which is a which is based on the Sea Judge Act. So when we see, we talk about what is happening. What is happening to our world? Why is it happening? Over here, we add on something that we call social analysis. We try to understand the root cause of why this is happening. And then in the judge, we use a theological reflection, which the Pope does in his book. And then how shall we respond? So this, so all through the Catholic social teaching, it's about seeing, analyzing, judging or reflecting on the Bible and church teaching and action. So I'm hoping that this conference will lead us to some positive action towards the problem. I can give you the slides if you want to, you know. Language, very important. You see the movie Moana? It's using the Polynesian language and action to communicate. The Pope uses what we call artistic language, the language that touches the heart. And this is the argument of Joe Holland and Peter Henriot, who wrote this book, Social Analysis, Linking Faith with Justice. And they are the ones that gave birth to the pastoral circle. Joe Holland and Peter Henriot argue that although social analysis helps us to understand the problem, they don't have the language to move people, to touch hearts. What they argue is that social analysis needs to be complemented with artistic language. So what do we mean by artistic language? And that is the language of spirituality, because it deals with the spirit. It includes culture. It includes poetry. It includes dances. You know, whatever is artistic. Why? Because a scientific language only speaks to educated people. You know, and that's what you hear from the government. People in university will tell you all the scientific knowledge about climate change. And that's my argument to the COP23 team when they visited me, because they did not include us in the conversation and the consultation about the COP23. And I told them, see, you need the language of the faith communities in the conversation about climate change. You people speak the scientific, we speak the spiritual, we also bring the cultural and the language that moves people. And especially in Oceania, where faith is at the center of our lives, different to New Zealand, Australia, US, where, you know, faith is being pushed to the margin. But here, you know, everybody believes in God. People go to church on Sunday or Saturday. So that is why it's important, especially for a place like our islands in the ocean, that the language of climate change should use the faith language, the spiritual language. So the Pope uses artistic language, phrases like our common home. He could have said our planet, our earth, but he chose a word that is resonates and people identify with, and that is our home. You know, we all care for our home. We want our children to have a better home. And he uses the words like sister, mother earth, Okay, another form of artistic language. The groaning of the earth and women, you know, some men to know, women who give birth know. One woman said, some men were complaining about pain, and this woman said, oh, you people don't know what pain is, man. Like pain of giving birth, eh? Yeah, we women, we know what it means to groan, eh? Yeah, when they give birth. Our earth is becoming like a pile of filth, you know. We don't want to see a pile of filth. I was going to Naitawuni up in Naitasiria, crossing the Sawani Road, I saw, and I was taking two Austrian ladies. I was ashamed to tell her, oh, there's a rubbish dump on the side of the bus stop there. We don't want to see a pile of filth in our house, you know. We, especially women, you want the house to be clean. We don't want our house to be like a pile of filth. So these are the kind of language that moves, that touches hearts. These are important things to note in this document. So I will just go very briefly about the chapters. I won't go into detail because you probably have read this. But chapter one is basically the sea. What is happening to our common home? So pollution, climate change, refuse, the culture of waste, climate is a common good, the issue of water, that water is for the common good, but now water has become a commodity, you have to buy water, you know. There's a lot of people making big business in Fiji just by taking up in that pastoral circle. Chapter 3 tries to do an analysis of why, what is happening, why is this happening. So the Pope goes a little bit deeper into trying to understand the root causes of the problems. As he said, you know, you cannot take this environment or climate change in a piecemeal. It's like this thing is it does not happen on its own. There are things that causes it. So he talks about technology and creativity and power and how this has been the cause of the problem. The globalization of technocratic paradigm, the crisis and effects of modern anthropocentrism. By this he means that in this world, like, we have become the center of everything and we use everything for our own good and forget that other creatures too have their own purpose in life. Practical relativism, something that Pope Benedict talked about, that, you know, that everything is relative, it's up to you, if it's okay with you. The need to protect employment and new biological technology. So this is like an analysis of why, what is happening. Then the chapter 4, it talks about integral ecology, where it talks about environmental, economic, social ecology, cultural ecology, ecology of daily life, the principle of the common good, one of the key principles of Catholic social teaching, and justice between generations. Then chapter 5 is the pastoral action. If you want to get some idea, what can we do? This gives us some pointers, what the Pope wants us to do. He wants us to engage in a dialogue on the environment. Dialogue in the international community, that we need to speak to the international community. Dialogue with new national and local policies. This is very important. That we need. I was talking to, when we were having this meeting yesterday, so I told the secretariat, he said, you know, it's good to do this 1 week prayer, but it's good to talk to the people on the ground about this, create awareness, but we should also talk to you people on top, the people who make the policies. So it has to be two-pronged, with the grassroots people, but also with government, because they are the ones who make the policies and the kind of development that either damages our environment or puts environment and the human person at the center. which is at the heart of the Catholic social teaching. You know, any development must have the human person, and now with the Laudato Si, and the environment at the center, and not just the company at the center. Okay? Then dialogue and transparency in decision making, so policy making, politics and economy in dialogue for human fulfillment, religions in dialogue with science. So these are some very practical line of action that we can use. And we have a great source with us, and that is our Catholic social teaching. And all this, we bring this to these conversations. Unfortunately, as many as some books have labeled, our Catholic social teaching is also our best kept secret. We have a big treasure, but we have kept it secretly to ourselves, or probably many of us don't even know. This is quite alarming. I've spoken to, this year, spoke to, some big conferences in Oceania and Asia Pacific. One was held in Brisbane. It's called the Association of Practical Theologians in Oceania, APTO. But most of the theologians are from Australia and New Zealand. I was the only one from here. When I spoke about Catholic social teaching and the pastoral circle, some of the theologians there, their eyes popped out. Eh? Because they said, oh, we've never heard a bishop talk about this pastoral circle. They claim or argue that it's too political. And I said, no, this thing is about pastoral effectivity. So it's quite alarming to hear that even from some big, some key theologians in the Pacific. Last month in Melbourne, there was a conference on Asia Pacific, something on globalization, also talked about Catholic social teaching. One lady from sister from India said, that's the first time he hears a bit of talking about Catholic social teaching. So somehow, this is quite alarming, you know. Key important theologians in Australia and Asia Pacific we are not well versed in our tradition, or we've kept it a secret. And then the chapter 6 is about ecological education and spirituality towards a new lifestyle. That's what I've been saying. This thing is about change of attitude, change of lifestyle. For you people in Fiji, we're trying to move away from the plastic. You know, if you go to the shop now, they will ask you, you want plastic or not? If you want plastic, you pay 10 cents. But it's not changing the lifestyle. Yeah, they still give you the plastic. The only change there that the shopkeeper gets another 10 cents. And the plastic is going to go somewhere else. We are trying to stop the plastic. Solution to the problem is stop manufacturing the plastic, get paper bags like what they're doing overseas. But we have not changed, we've changed things but not changed our lifestyle. Yeah? So, towards a new lifestyle, educating for the covenant between humanity and the environment. Pope calls for ecological conversion. You know, we talk about conversion from our sins during Lent, but here it's about ecological conversion, the way we look at our environment, you know? The way we get rid of rubbish and things like that. Joy and peace and civic political love, sacramental signs and the celebration of the rest, Trinity and relationships with creatures, and ends with a section on our Mother Mary, as all encyclicals will do. Eh? So that's very basically the overview. Now I'd like to move on to other, that's the document. You can go and read it. Most of you have read it, but just a very brief run to it. Now, important thing here is how we bring this into our context. How does this apply to Fiji or to the Oceania? So over here, I'd like to just go through some of the state of the environment report by Caritas. So the 5 key environmental issues that Caritas in Oceania are monitoring each year. Actually, there's another one, the financial thing, but I've just to bring it to our level here, is the environmental factors affecting people's access to safe, healthy food and drinking water, coastal erosion, flooding and rising seas, offshore mining and drilling, and extreme weather. These are the things that Caritas monitors in order to get a profile and to get what is the state of the environment in the ocean. Yeah. So environmental factors affecting the people's access to safe, healthy food and drinking water. So the report says the El Nino weather pattern hit widely across the Pacific in 2015 and 2016, causing severe food and water shortages across the region. Where food is usually abundant, it has become scarce. People were forced to travel long distances for water and food. Malnutrition and long-term impacts were evident at the end of our reporting period. Number two, so these are some of the impacts of climate change. The contamination of fresh water with salt water. Number two is coastal erosion. Flooding and rising water. Coastal erosion has been happening in the Pacific gradually but relentlessly, as observed by communities over the decade. Though coastal erosion arises from a number of causes, we are seeing increasing anecdotal and scientific evidence of the role of ongoing sea level rise. Rising seas are no longer affecting not only the low-lying islands, but also the volcanic ones too. Coastal erosion and flooding is causing increased movement and dislocation or relocating people. Eh? So some of the impacts of climate change, according to this report, the Earth climate is warming, as is now evident from the observations of increases in global average air and ocean temperatures, widespread of melting of snow and ice, and a rising global sea level. Offshore mining and drilling. This is a big thing in Papua New Guinea. They say there's a big bed of mining in Tonga. In Fiji, there's some places in Yasawa. They've mapped that place along that place as having this thing that they want to mine underwater. So indigenous peoples most likely to be affected by offshore activities. We note the growing community concerns across Pacific about deep sea mining, including from various churches in the region. But there's little acknowledgement of this by governments, and mining companies downplay the potential impacts of offshore mineral, oil, gas exploration in the region. Number four, okay, there's some mining, Boer copper mine. This is the biggest, this is a gold rock. Dasamu quarry is a big stone quarry there. Impacting the food security down there. I was told that people are coming right up to Natobi to go and look for fish and things like that. The coral in this area is because of the silt, the soil that comes out from the river, because there's no more stones, the water just floods down and with all the soil, and it's covering the shores. It's becoming no longer sandy but muddy. And it's affecting the coral, and so the fish that depend on the coral are now going elsewhere. Namosi mining, so these are just some in Fiji. Papua New Guinea, as you know, is big in this. Then the last one is extreme weather, as we all know. This is the little bit of the climate profile here in Fiji. So some impacts of climate change in the Pacific is the... So there's a report here, drowning neighbors. Deaths from weather-related disasters have already increased in the region by 21% since the 1970s. That's a big increase. People have died by disaster. Cyclone's wind speed also predicted to increase by 10 to 20% in the next few years. That means there will be more Category 6. And then projected increase in the power of tropical storms. Okay. Deterioration of coastal conditions because of erosion, sea level rising, storm surge, erosion. And so these are some other impacts of the global, of the climate change. Kiribati study found that in the absence of adaptation, if we don't make any adaptation, up to 50 to 80% of land areas in North Tarawa and 25 to 54% of the area of South Tarawa could be inundated by 2050. That means there will be no more land there. Chita Beneta, you have to buy one land over here. Yeah, recent World Bank Kiribati could experience flooding by rising sea waters up to 80%. So this, for some of our brothers and sisters, this is really, it's no joke. So there's just some images. The world global average for sea level rise is this 3.2 to 0.4 mm per year. Tonga it's going at 6 mm. Big rate. So by 2030 this will be the, it'll move from 0.4 to 5, even 50. Sea levels may be more, as this does not take into account the ice sheet disintegrating processes which have a major impact on the global sea level rise. Where is this, Patel? Yeah, so some of the ways of dealing, sand in Tuvalu. The threat of sea level rise may bring a complete disaster to 11,000 Tuvaluans currently residing on 9 extremely low-lying coral atolls. So it's not only about moving then, but also they have to move to a new culture, whether they move to Fiji or somewhere, it's changing. Fiji, this too is happening here. People living in 34 coastal villages in Fiji face upheaval in the next few years as they relocate their homes because of rising water. There's a village already in somewhere in the Tunlo there. They moved from the coast up with the help of the European Union. Fiji governments have identified villages as likely to suffer the effects of climate change. One village in Bua province has already been relocated to Andua. This is a man from Tukabezi. That's he's pointing to where the sea level used to be before, but now he's moved over here. These are some photos that I took in Lakemba on the road to Wadi Wadi. The road is being eroded because by the waves. The waves cross it. Some other shots from some other places. Solomon Island, Vanuatu. So coral bleaching is also one of the impacts of climate change, which will affect the fish, because they feed on the fish. Mangrove forests will be under threat. In a few years' time, we will lose our mangroves. I was just, if you notice in Natobi, you see mangrove right in front of the church. No mangrove. You know why? Some people told me because in early days, they built the church on the coral they took out from that front shore. That's why there's no mangrove. Once we interfere with the ecosystem, it has an impact on other things. So we're going to lose all that coral if we are not careful. Climate change refugee is an important thing now. People are becoming refugees because of the climate change. Here, Papua New Guinea, some other Cataract Islands, Papua New Guinea, Tuvalu, probably will be the first to be evacuated because of climate change. Another island in Vanuatu, these are people who will become climate change refugees. So Caritas climate profile for Fiji in the next, Fiji now, the annual maximum, minimum temperatures have increased both in Suva and Nandi since 1950, been increase in temperature. In Suva now, the temperatures have increased at a rate of 0.15 Celsius degree, Nandi 18. Rainfall, they say there's not much change in the rainfall. Ocean acidification has been increasing. So that means the ocean is becoming more acidic. About one quarter of the carbon dioxide emitted from the from our bus and cars and everything go into the seawater. It causes the ocean to become slightly more acidic, and this impacts the growth of coral and fish and things that live under the sea. These species are critical to the balance of the tropical reef ecosystem. So data show that since 18th century, the sea level of the level of the ocean acidification has been slowly increasing in Fiji waters. They say over here they used to get kaikoso and things like that. In Lamy they can get the rengenge and that kind of thing. What's a small mussel? The thing, orange, huh? Yeah, but those are no more now. So the future of Fiji's climate, temperature will continue to rise, more hot days, changing rainfall patterns, more extreme rainfall days, less frequent but more intense tropical cyclones. Sea level will continue to rise, ocean acidification will continue. So it's gloomy, the Fiji climate profile. Eh? You can go to Caritas and check your own country's profile. But this is Fiji's what you can expect in terms of the environment and how we bring Laudatus in there. So climate change is the biggest threat to reducing poverty today. 90% of the people who die in natural resources live in the poorest countries. Okay. So what do we do with this? We Pope uses theological reflection, reflects on the gospel of creation, considers the world the way that God intended it. What is God's purpose about the world? The key themes in his theological reflection is the responsibility that we have for creation, the connectedness that we have, that Archbishop Martin talks about, neighbor, creation, God. This is our responsibility to all creatures, human beings, environment, and to God. It's a responsibility of everyone. And that this is drawn from the Pope's reflection on our tradition. Eh? So the creation story gives us food for thought there. The God who liberates, saves, and saves is the same God who created the universe. It's not only created human beings, but also the universe. So we are connected, closely intertwined with a relationship with God, our neighbor, and the earth itself. According to the Bible, these three vital relationships have been broken, both outwardly and within us. And this is the sin of the world, the rupture of sin, because our connectedness has been broken. So Pope calls us to shift only not the common good, but also the planetary good, the good of the creation. Every creature has its own purpose. They should be respected. And so the chapter 2 ends with the heart of Christian revelation, the earthly Jesus with his tangible and loving relationship with the world, is risen, glorious, and is present throughout creation. Now just finally, apart from our religious tradition, we, in Fiji and in the Pacific, we have a very strong spirituality. The Vanua, the Fenua, the Hanua, what else? Fonua. And this expresses our spirituality, our connectedness with the land, living things on the land, and the world of spirits. In the ritual for the installation of the chiefs, when they drink their first meal of Yankon as chief, they promise to be custodians of the Vanua. I spoke to our Catholic chiefs on this, you know, that you are a chief because you say yes to respect, not only respect, but protect and uphold the whole of the Vanua. And that means, you know, saying no to money because you want to protect the people, the land, and their resources. And that is the big challenge for our chiefs as they stand between Vanua and money. But this is also a very strong language, useful language for us in the Oceania, the use of the spirituality of the Vanua. Action plan for climate change in the Pacific. We are not drowning, we are fighting. That's what should be our language. Eh? So I want to leave us there because Pope, in his letter on Misericordia Vultus, Jubilee Eremus, this is an opportune moment to change our lives. This is the time to allow our hearts to be changed. Eh? So what can we do? On these key areas, eh? What can we do? How are you individually called to participate in caring for the God's creation? How we can encourage dialogue with Catholic community, parish, school, colleges, universities, and also with our civil leaders. So both angles. Eh? And I'd like to end there. Thank you very much.